afternoon, everyone, and a very warm welcome to you all. My name is Anuj Sonpal, CEO of Valorem Advisors. We represent the investor relations of Century Textiles and Industries Limited. Firstly, on behalf of the company, I would like to thank you all for participating in this event. I would also like to thank the management participating with us today and for giving us the opportunity to host them for our Valorem CXO Meet. As you may already be aware by now, the Valorem CXO Meet is a first of its kind virtual analyst meet event series. And our intention with these virtual CXO meets is to take advantage of technology platforms like this by reaching out to a wider audience and to create a better understanding and bring awareness about our client company's fundamental business, provide insights into their specific industry, financials, and future growth strategies. Excuse me. The format of this analyst meet will be primarily in a Q&A interview format, where I will start off by asking the management some broad level questions and then move on to questions from the participants. Please note that if you have, if you would like to ask any questions, you can do so by using the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen to post them there. And I will ask the management these questions on your behalf after I have asked the initial broad level questions. Now, before I begin, I would like to mention a short cautionary statement. Some of the statements made in today's event may be forward-looking in nature. Such forward-looking statements are subject to risks and uncertainties, which would cause actual results to differ from those anticipated. Such statements are based on management's beliefs, as well as assumptions made by and information currently available to management. Audiences are cautioned not to place any undue reliance on these forward-looking statements in making any investment decisions. Now, let me introduce you to the management participating with us today. First off, we have with us Mr. J.C. Ladda. Good afternoon, sir. How are you?
Good afternoon. Hello, everybody.
Mr. J.C. Ladda is the Managing Director of Century Textiles and Industries Limited. Mr. Ladda has a vast and rich business leadership experience of over 38 years. He has been associated with the Aditya Birla Group for over three decades, with his last assignment being at Hindalco Industries Limited, where he had led the copper business as its CEO. He has handled leadership positions across diverse industry sectors and also specialized functions in his illustrious career. Apart from the Aditya Birla Group, Mr. Ladda also has had previous stints with Hindustan Unilever, National Rayon Corporation, and Mangalore Refineries and Petrochemicals Limited. Mr. Ladda is a fellow chartered accountant by qualification. We next have with us Mr. R.K. Dalmia. Good afternoon, sir. Mr. Dalmia is the Senior President of Century Textiles and a whole-time director of the company. Mr. Dalmia is a chartered accountant by qualification and has been with the group since the last four decades. He started his stint as the Vice President in the Technological Institute of Textiles and Sciences, Haryana, and subsequently ascended to the position of President in 1983. In 1985, he was assigned the responsibility of improving the technical performance of Century Textiles Mill. Under his stewardship, the mill went on to win numerous accolades from the textile industry. We next have with us Mr. KT Jitendran. Good afternoon, KT.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone.
Mr. Jitendran is the Chief Executive Officer of Birla Estates. He has over 26 years of work experience in the realty sector. Prior to joining Birla Estates, he was involved with the Godrej Properties Limited as an executive director. He has led most functions within the company while managing growth as well as building a strong, talented team. A civil engineer from IIT Kharagpur, Mr. Jitendran also completed a postgraduate diploma in management from IIM Kolkata and advanced management program from Harvard Business School. We next have with us Mr. JP Narayan, who unfortunately is in between traveling and therefore his video may be off just to save on his bandwidth. Good afternoon, Mr. Narayan. Can you hear us?
Yeah, good afternoon, everyone.
Mr. Narayan is the Chief Executive Officer of Century Pulp and Paper. He has accumulated rich experience in his professional life spanning over 28 years. Through his association with various FMCG companies like Reckitt Benckiser India Limited, Saab Miller, and also PepsiCo at various levels. Throughout his professional life, he has had an enviable track record of having introduced efficient manufacturing processes along with cost reduction in manufacturing operations. He's a bachelor in technology from Gujarat Agricultural University. Post his graduation, he enriched his management skills through a diploma in management from IIM Calcutta. Last but not least, we have with us Mr. Snehal Shah. Good afternoon, Mr. Shah.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Mr. Shah is the Chief Financial Officer of Century Textile and Industries Limited. He's a seasoned management professional specializing in business strategy with a cumulative experience of over 30 years in operations, business process, risk management, MIS administration, vendor management, and team building. His expertise spans across financial services, metals, cement, carbon black, textiles, chemicals, and refineries. A chartered accountant by qualification, Mr. Shah headed the corporate management services division at Aditya Birla Group for over 4 years before donning the mantle of the CFO at Century Textiles and Industries Limited. Mr. Shah was also appointed, also a part of the Aditya Birla Capital for more than 12 years, wherein he helmed the financial shared services operations apart from the corporate operations of their life insurance wing. Now, without any further delay, let's begin. I start with my first question to Mr. Ladda. Mr. Ladda, could you start with giving our viewers a brief history and background about the company and the transformational change that the company has taken in the last 5 years, especially with the sale of the cement division and then the launch of the real estate division? Over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Anuj. Good afternoon to everybody. As many of you are aware that Century Textiles and Industries Limited has a rich legacy of over 123 years. In 1951, this business came in the fold of Birla's. Since then, the company has consistently diversified into various segments, right from rayon, tire cord, chemicals, cement, pulp and paper. Considering its diversification into various business segments, in 1987, the company was renamed as Century Textiles and Industries Limited. Earlier, it was known as Century Spinning and Weaving Company Limited. In 2016, CTIL ventured into the realty sector under the brand name Birla Estates. This was mainly to effectively develop and monetize the huge land bank which CTIL had accumulated over the years in prime areas, especially in Mumbai. Birla Estates has about 120 acres of land bank. The area under development is about 90 lakh square feet, having a revenue potential of over 16,000 crores. As you are all aware, CTIL cement business got demerged or merged with UltraTech in 2019, mainly due to their synergies and to unlock the full potential for growth of its cement business. Cement business had a very minor market share of about 3%, and due to high debt levels, CTIL did not have the ability to invest in its sustenance and growth. Given the large potential in the realty sector and its relative position in the cement business, it was decided to demerge the cement business. This demerger helped in deleveraging CTIL's balance sheet with the transfer of rupees 3,000 crores of debt to UltraTech, which then would help grow the real estate business. Post this, now CTIL has three focused businesses. One is real estate, pulp and paper, and Century Textiles. Starting with Century Textiles, although Birla Century was established in 2009, CTIL and its relationship with textiles started way back in 1897 when the company forayed into manufacturing of fabric. Today, Birla Century leads the textile market with a premium cotton textile products. Over 100 acres of a vertically integrated manufacturing facility in Bharuch, Gujarat is equipped with state-of-the-art machinery to develop customized weave, design, and texture. Birla Century is the world's second and India's first LEED accredited leadership in energy and environmental design gold V4 textile manufacturing company. Coming to Century Pulp and Paper, it was established in 1984 with a relentless focus on quality. We manufacture international grade products and are now a leading player in India's pulp and paper industry. It manufactures high quality writing and printing paper, tissue paper, and board. In its state of the art manufacturing facility located at the foothills of the Himalayas in Uttarakhand, we provide employment to the local community, thus generating opportunities for them and improving their livelihood. As of now, it is one of the top five players in the country and has plans to become the market leader. Now, coming to our foray into realty sector, Birla Estates' guiding philosophy is life designed, drawing inspiration from the influencing the lives we touch through our projects. Each life design project is meticulously perfected to nurture and enrich people's life. We collaborate with various domain experts to provide our customers with not just a good lifestyle, but also a good ecosystem that is designed around their lives. Birla Estate is a new startup and has the vision to win the top three real estate players over the next 5 years. Apart from this, while STD performance and augmenting value for our stakeholders are our priorities, sustainability and customer centricity remain our key focus areas. We make extensive use of cutting-edge technologies across the entire value chain and empower our employees towards fulfilling our corporate vision. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Taking cue from that, let me move on to the next question to Mr. Jitendran. Mr. Jitendran, to start with, can you please highlight the commercial and residential real estate projects undertaken by the company over the last few years? And also, what are the upcoming projects in the pipeline? And if you could, also cover the total sellable area and revenue potential for each of them.
Sure. Thank you, Anuj. Good afternoon, friends. It's a pleasure to talk to all of you today evening. Just giving you a very brief overall view of Birla Estates business. So we have two very premium commercial projects situated in the heart of Mumbai, one in Prabhadevi called Birla Aurora and the other in Worli called Birla Centurion. Both these buildings are fully built, both are LEED Platinum buildings, and it is almost fully leased out. We are getting an annual revenue of about 125 crores plus per annum, and we have some of the best top graded multinational companies and top Indian companies as our tenants here. So this gives a very strong bedrock of cash flow, steady cash flows for our business. Apart from that, Birla Estates or Century Textiles, namely, owns very, very premium land parcels again in the heart of Mumbai. We own about 40 acres in Worli, which is the Century Textile Mill, of which 30 acres are up for development. We are hoping that we'll bring this into the market very soon. We have a potential of almost about 4 million plus square feet. It will be a mix of residential, commercial, and retail, with a total revenue potential of close to 15,000 plus crores or thereabouts over a period of about 8 to 10 years. We have another very, very premium parcel in Prabhadevi, which is about 2 acres on the beach. Very, very premium again, high potential residential, very premium area location. Apart from that, we have 100 plus acres in Kalyan, of which we have already started developing 22 acres of that land parcel. Of this 22 acres, we launched the first phase in the last financial year, and we got tremendous response there. Our total potential is about 1.3 million square feet here. We have almost sold out to the first phase, and we are gearing up for the launch of the second phase. So that's the story of Kalyan. We have another very large land parcel in Pune near Talegaon, which is about 45 acres with a potential of 2.5 million square feet, which will come up for development in the next few years. So this is what we own. Apart from that, we have got into joint venture with a few landowners, the most premium being in NCR in Gurgaon. On golf course extension, we have tied up with a joint venture with Anantraj Estates for about 65 odd acres with a potential of almost 3.6 million square feet, which is 4,000 crore plus top line revenue. I think this should fructify in the next 7 to 8 years with very high margin potential. Similarly, in Bangalore, we bought one property in the outskirts of Whitefield, which is worth 8 acres, which we launched again sometime in November last year. And we got, again, very strong response, very differentiated product, extremely well appreciated by the market. We have signed another profit-sharing joint venture in the heart of the Bangalore city in Magadi Road, which is about 5.5 lakh square feet. We are hoping to launch sometime in the first quarter of next financial year. That's a profit sharing venture. So these are some of the things that we have already done. And we are in the market looking for several more, you know, joint venture development opportunities. Our focus markets are Mumbai, Bangalore, NCR, and Pune. Our model right now is, to go into the asset light joint venture business model, focus on mid to premium segment, because we believe in very high quality and timely delivery. I think that could be attained only through, partnership with strong A-grade contractors. And therefore, we need to operate in a certain basic, selling price level. So therefore, I think we will be operating in the premium plus segment until we consolidate and we grow into a fairly large player. And then we start flanking the other segments also. So broadly, Anuj, that's what we have and this our overall plan. Does that answer your question?
Yeah, great. Thank you for that, sir. Let me ask you a follow-up question. And this is more probably related to a little bit on the industry and strategic side for Birla Estates. There is a general perception that the real estate market is not doing so well. It's probably in the doldrums. And more specifically, there is news that, there's a good amount of unsold inventory in the cities that we are present in. Through your extensive experience in this industry, can you explain, your thoughts on the overall industry, what it's going through right now, especially in this post-COVID era? And also specifically to Birla Estates, being a fairly new entrant, how does the company plan to differentiate itself and compete against these established players like Godrej and Oberoi, et cetera?
Thank you, Anuj. Very relevant question, I must say. As you know, in the last few years, the industry has been badgered with several landmark events. We were first, the first impact was the demonetization, which impacted the industry adversely in a very large way. And on the back of it came the RERA, which imposed several strong rules, and regulations and the restriction of cash flows. And that was followed by the NBFC crisis. And that again impacted very badly, followed by GST. So there were, not one, but multiple factors which impacted the real estate. What followed was, there was a huge amount of consolidation that happened in the industry across geographies. So the number of players in the industry reduced by more than half because of these several strong shocks which the industry gave. But the silver lining was that branded players started getting credence. So now the industry is inexorably moving towards a situation where the number of players are reducing, consolidation is getting accelerated, and with the latest event of COVID-19, this only got further accelerated. So I think for somebody like a Birla Estate is a huge opportunity to being a branded, trusted, valued, player with a strong brand value across the country. So I think it's a great time for somebody like us with strong balance sheet, of a parent company, et cetera, to take full advantage of it. The winners that we have is we ourselves have a very strong, land bank. We have a steady cash flow from our existing commercial lease rentals. We have a very strong strategy in place. We are extremely focused on sustainability. Sustainability, the pillar of our execution. We are laser sharp focused on execution and timely delivery. I think that's the most important thing. And I think, rather than getting into large number of projects, how well you deliver in timely factor with a focus on what our customer needs. We intend to be the most customer centric organization. And I think all of our processes and systems are all attuned towards that. Even when you do design for a project, we do extensive research, we do a prototype, we go back to the market, to the consumer, to validate the design, do appropriate changes. I think that's the key thing. I think the real estate industry, we are all responsible for that. We took the customer for granted. And I think that period is over with the RERA setting in, et cetera. The customer has got a very strong voice now. And I think we need to appreciate and respect that. And that's what we absolutely plan to do. And I think that will put us in a very strong pedestal. As you know, the industry post-COVID, I think things are coming back. There have been several good things. The government has now put into practice some of the, put into motion some good initiatives. The housing loan is at an all-time low. I think it's one of the best housing loan, you know, incentives available for the consumers. I think states like Maharashtra has cut down the stamp duty. There are also further talks going about reducing the premiums of, you know, of development charges, etc. I think all this could be great incentives. There has been pent up demand now suddenly with, you know, lots of developers doing you know, giving concessions, you know, payment plan extensions and all that. I think the, there is buoyancy in the market. Real estate is also emerging as an alternate real as an investment option now. So I think the industry is bouncing back. Residential is coming back strongly. Of course, there is a tilt towards ready to move in or ready possession, you know, properties. But I think the branded players will definitely attract a lot of attraction. I think that is given. I think the branded players will also be able to attract premium. I think we have been able to do that in all our markets, be it Kalyan in Bombay, be it Bangalore. We are selling at least 15-20% above market. We got very strong volume traction also. Same feature we are observing in NCR market in Gurgaon. Great volumes and, you know, expectations. I think the brand speaks for itself. Also, I think post-COVID, the house has become very important, the residential, because house is not just a place where you stay and get out of in the morning and come back in the night. House is where you do your, you know, it in the morning, it's a fitness lounge. In the daytime, it's a place where you do your virtual schooling, you do your work, your office, etc. And the evening, it is an entertainment lounge. So house has become very important now. So people are looking for larger spaces. People are moving from rental to owning. So I think the housing, residential housing is going to have a huge, huge demand in the future. And people are going to pay a lot of attention to design, efficiency of planning, etc. So I think that is where the, you know, the real estate developers should focus on. Moving on to the commercial market, I think, you know, though there has been a temporary blip because of work from home, people are extending their work from home, but I don't think in the long run, the Indian household can support working from home for a very long, our household. I mean, I'm talking about the larger scheme of things, you know. So I think the offices will come back, especially the large IT requirements, etc. And I think Indian office rentals are one of the cheapest, lowest in the world. If you take exclude Mumbai and, you know, NCR, the others have $1, $1.50, which I think should be, you know, the most affordable thing, and backed by, I think most global companies prefer India as a destination because of this, and also the skilled manpower. And also, you know, the data, I mean, Indians are quite data savvy. So a lot of data centers are coming up. So I think the commercial story is going to be there in the medium to long term. There has been a temporary setback, but I think that will come back. The one which has got most impacted is the retail. I think retail has almost become less than 50%. Concessions have been huge in the retail sector. I think Indian malls, once this vaccine and other things come back, because Indian malls are more like, you know, where people go to experience it. It's an entertainment zone because there's no other entertainment options in India. It's much more than a shopping destination. So I think that will bring the retails back into focus. I think once this scare of, you know, the pandemic goes off. So I think that should also come. I think overall, I think I see a very strong future for real estate. On the back of this, I think this just coming back. I think this has been pandemic has been a place where, you know, people took stock of their things, they managed their costs, overheads, etc. And I think the future, I think this should be a huge springboard to generate for the demand. That's my opinion.
Fair enough, Mr. Jitendran. That was very, very insightful for sure. Let me move on to Mr. JP Narayan now. Mr. Narayan, can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay, great. So moving on to Century Pulp and Paper, Mr. Narayan, could you give our viewers an overview of our plant infrastructure and our product portfolio, and also then talk about the current industry environment at the ground level since the COVID pandemic has hit the paper industry pretty badly. especially in the writing and printing segment, and how CPP is performing in relation to that.
Sure, Anuj. Hi, good evening to everyone, and it's a pleasure talking to you all on Century Pulp and Paper Business. Our manufacturing facility is situated in the foothills of Himalaya and district Nainital. And right now we have got a manufacturing capacity of 450,000 tons. I think COVID, I can say it was a threat for the pulp and paper industry, but for Century Pulp and Paper, it has given us an opportunity to think and diversify. Pre-COVID, we were in the range of, you can say, 55% writing printing paper and 45% in tissue and packaging board. And during COVID, we have commissioned our new tissue line, and we have also carried out certain modification on our writing printing machines on which we can produce, you can say, variant like kappa product or the packaging product. And if I now reconfigure the portfolio of Century Pulp and Paper, earlier, which was considered as a writing printing and a, you can say the paper manufacturing company, now we are slightly tilting toward a packaging manufacturing company rather than the writing printing manufacturing company. Because now our portfolio is touching somewhere around 55 to 58% in packaging and tissue, and it's a 45% writing printing segment. And in future, it's going to reduce further. Because what we learned, especially in writing printing paper, I think the COVID has brought a good amount of deceleration in this segment. And what we were anticipating in next 10 years, it had come in this 1 year during the COVID time. So it has given us an opportunity to think and diversify it faster. And during that this time, we have, you can say, the diversified in a bigger way. We have produced many new products, which was a replacement for a plastic in terms of biodegradable. And many other hygiene products, like you can say single use bed roll for hospital, as well as you can say the railway. There was a barber hygiene kit that was a single use and absolutely hygienic, where you can say the hygiene was the top priority. So these were the, you can say, the thought process which COVID has asked us to think and work upon. If I talk on a portfolio and the diversification of Century Pulp and Paper, I think we are operating in three segments. That's a writing printing paper, packaging, and tissue. Our writing printing paper segment is coming down gradually. And right now, I think in current scenario, we are in the range of somewhere around 45%. And 55% is covered in the tissue and packaging segment. If I talk about the growth of these three segments, internationally, writing printing is growing at the range of 0.5 to 1%. Tissue is growing at the rate of 7.5 to 9%, whereas the packaging board is growing at the rate of 6 to 7% on internationally. If you talk in the domestic market, tissue is growing at the rate of somewhere at 10 to 12%. Packaging board is growing at the rate of 8 to 10%, whereas the writing printing was growing pre-COVID era in the range of 4.5 to 5%. But I'm anticipating that this growth will be subdued after COVID, because the trend of writing printing is getting changed. So right now, if we see the portfolio of Century Pulp and Paper, we are more focused on tissue, which is the hygiene and wellness product. And second is the packaging, and third is the writing printing paper. We had recently commissioned our new tissue line, and our capacity has become double. Earlier, we were producing somewhere 36,000 tons tissue on a yearly basis. With the new additional capacity, now our capacity will touch somewhere 72,000 tons on a yearly basis, and we will be a leading player in the country in tissue manufacturing. Packaging, we are on number two right now. And in future, I think we are also thinking to expand our footprint in packaging, either in duplex board or in virgin board. But this is our thought process. Nothing had frozen right now on this segment. Writing printing paper, we are carrying it right now. What gradually we will shift all the machines gradually in the packaging side. And in future, what we are anticipating wellness as well as the packaging company in play. At the place, you can say right now, in place of writing printing, we are planning to shift our focus gradually on the hygiene and wellness product and the packaging products. So that is the kind of, you can say, the portfolio writing print, Century Pulp and Paper is handling right now. And we are seeing a good growth, especially in packaging segment, because the packaging segment growth is proportional to food, pharma, FMCG, as well as the FMCD industries. And if you see the Indian growth in these three, all three or four industries, it's growing at the rate of somewhere around 6.5 to 8% on a CAGR basis. So we don't see any threat, especially in the hygiene segment, as well as in the packaging segment, if you see the future growth. Yeah, writing printing, I think right now it's passing through a bad time, but I'm quite confident that once the institutions, academic session and school university will start, it will gradually come up. What we are seeing from next year, all the syllabus is getting changed. And once this, that reprinting of new books and textbooks will be there, there will be a huge demand for next 2 to 3 years in the writing printing segment also. So that is the scenario of pulp and paper business at present. And I think future, I'm seeing a good future, especially for Century Pulp and Paper, because we have got a big and very diverse portfolio. So Anuj, hope I had answered your question. If you have got any other question, I will add.
No, absolutely, sir. Thank you so much for that. Moving on to the textile segment, Mr. Dalmia, you know, the Century Textiles has a legacy of over 100 years in the textiles industry. So can you throw some light on our textiles business, the product portfolio, and some of the clients across geographies that we cater to?
Sure. Thank you, Anuj. And good evening to all of you. It is my real pleasure to talk today to all of you. As you all know, Century is for its quality textile product with its legacy since 1897. After closure of its Mumbai unit in 2008, Century has set up a brand new factory, namely Birla Century at Bharuch in 2009. The plant has its best state-of-art technology, which are available in the world, and manufacture a wide range of premium textiles. It is a green factory and zero water discharge. Birla Century manufacture a premium range of elite shirting, cotton trousers fabric, range of finer fabrics in variety of designs, weaves, color, and catering mostly to the brands, exporters, traders, as well as ready-to-stitch over-counter market. It further manufactures premium home textiles, which include a wide range of bedsheets, mainly for the international market. As I said, it is a green factory, and we have all the certification from the world-renowned Accreditation Institute. We certify for product safety, safe environment, social performance expectations, healthy working conditions, sustainability, as required by any global brand and applicable for textile industry. You name any certificate which any textile company has in the world and which are available for textile industry, we have all. The company has put up emphasis on the innovation and sustainability and has launched Birla Care brand, under which a lot of development is done for healthy and hygiene product for both domestic and overseas markets. The product are very much in demand after this pandemic, and we are satisfying our customers across the globe with timely delivery. We have our presence in US, Canada, UK, Australia, Philippines, Hong Kong, Bangladesh, apart from Indian markets. Our buyer base include international clients such as Macy's, Costco, Bed Bath Beyond, CHF, and domestic brands such as US Polo, Aero, Louis Philippe, Van Heusen, Allen Solly, etc. The capacity wise, we have, it is an integrated textile mill. Right from spinning, we buy only cotton, and then other fiber just like modal, viscose, and we spin our own. We have 6,500 ton capacity of spinning per annum. Then we have 302 looms, around 23 million meters per annum. Then we have process house of 38 million meters per annum, and the stitching factory of 7 million meters per annum. The total fabric is produced in the factory in Bharuch. Of course, we are some outsourcing the fabric, but all the processing in our factory inside. Stitching we are doing of our own. Post-COVID, we have started factory on 4th May. So practically, factory was closed for 1.5 months. After that, from the starting day one, the home textile business was running from the full capacity. Until now, we are running on full capacity. Apparel business gradually has improved. It is around 90% capacity we are running at present. And market are stabilized for us because we are in the mainly on the quality products, which have not affected much to us and the overseas market. From October onwards, we are on EBITDA plus also. We are not losing any, meeting out all fixed cost and plus EBITDA. So post-COVID, looking to the textile industry situation, which we are really facing a lot of problems, we are very comfortable as compared to our competitors in the textile industry. So I can say what this pays to us, our fair business policies, our timely delivery and quality products. Practically our complaints are from the market are practically zero. And whatever customer feedbacks are there, we are very open to listen them and to improve them. Since our product is goes to international market to big brands, just like Messi, Costco and all, there are always a surprise audits regularly, frequently, which go around the entire factory and looks about the many social, the economic things, social responsibility, meeting workers independently, individually, and we are complying all the requirement without any fail. So these are our strength, which are the reason we are surviving the textile market. Any other thing, Anuj?
No, sir. I think that was very, very informative. Thank you for that. Now, before I take questions from the participants, I'll ask one final question to Mr. Snehal Shah. Snehalji, considering that the company is aggressively expanding now into real estate over the next few years, there would be obviously a high requirement of capital. So how does, can you just, you know, elaborate to our viewers, how does the company plan to fund these upcoming projects? And also, how do we expect the business mix, revenues and profitability to change in the medium to long term?
So thank you, Anuj. Really a pleasure to be with all of you today. So Anuj, before I answer your specific question, I will just kind of take some time to, you know, brief everyone about our finances during the COVID times. So in FY20 itself, we had faced some headwinds in both our manufacturing businesses, that is textiles and pulp and paper, due to the general economic slowdown in FY20. And our revenues and EBITDA numbers were down by about 8% and 22% respectively. At the same time, our real estate business, you know, was kind of showing a good traction, which actually meant that we, you know, we had to put in capital. So cash flows were a bit stretched, and we also had 700 crores of a bond repayment, which was due in April 20. But the businesses actually were seeing a reversing trend in the Q4 of FY20. So pre-COVID, they were actually all hopeful of a good FY21. And when we closed our planning and budgeting exercise in Feb 20, we were kind of having a fair bit of idea about the cash needs. Interest rates were kind of reasonably low around that time. And we already had a deleveraged balance sheet, so to say, post cement demerger. So also, so we could get good interest rates, in fact, much better than a AA rated company, which that we are right now. So we used that opportunity to raise close to 1100 crores before actually COVID hit us. Now, out of this 1100 crores, about 700 crores, as I mentioned earlier, was used to replace the old debt of 700 crores. And we had, now what we can probably call a war chest of 400 crores with us, which actually at that time was sort of a mandate to meet the needs of the fast growing real estate business. And yes, of course, during the COVID times, our revenues and profits certainly, like everybody else, did take a significant hit. But actually, in terms of cash flows, we were in a really relatively very comfortable position. Another advantage we had, I would say, was having a diversified business, you know, diversified businesses. So if in what happens is if one business was impacted and the other was benefited, it kind of squared off the numbers for us. For example, I mean, paper had a relatively, say, good Q1 and textile had a relatively good Q2. Real estate also too started showing good traction from Q2 onwards. So, and of course, further, like everyone else, everybody's focus shifted to conserving cash and controlling fixed costs, which we did extremely well. To a certain extent, CapEx programs were deferred and new business deals, particularly in the real estate business, we put them on a pause mode for the situation to become more conducive. So as you know, we had demerged our cement division in FY19, and hence, as Ladda ji already mentioned, a good amount of debt was off the books and the balance sheet was kind of deleveraged. Also, we had already raised, as I mentioned earlier, long-term debt just before COVID hit us. So that was actually assuming a requirement for a, you know, sort of a normal year. So there was really no pressure of raising funds. Incidentally, our debt levels are today still at pre-COVID levels. So there was really no need to access capital. And in fact, we used the scenario of, the falling interest rates and the liquidity impetus due to measures announced by the government and the RBI to actually reset our existing borrowings by almost 100 basis points. Let me now take your specific question. I mean, maybe with a bit of a general financial strategy of a diversified business. You know, the strategies, as you know, are mainly around allocation of capital, contribution to the bottom line and cash flows by each businesses, stage in the evolution of the businesses, business cycles of each business, among other things, and pitching your strategies, kind of keeping these parameters in mind. From that perspective, currently for our existing manufacturing businesses, we are looking at only maintenance and regulatory capex in the textile business. For the paper business, post capex already spent in the expansion of the tissue capacity, we are kind of looking at a spend of an average 50 crores per year for improvements and retrofitting to marginally increase the capacities and or change mix. But at the same time, we are also kind of evaluating proposals. In fact, I'm probably preempting one of the questions that somebody has asked already about the 500 crores number that we have put. So these are, we are actually not planned, but evaluating proposals in the paper business to more significantly kind of increase capacities, both organically and inorganically, particularly with kind of shorter payback periods for them to be kind of self-supporting the capex spends in terms of contribution to the EBITDA against the debt that may have to be raised for the programs. So post above whatever I've said, we kind of envisage that the manufacturing businesses will kind of contribute around 700 crores of free cash flows for the company in the next 3 years, including the, of course, the current financial year. Now moving on to the real estate business, I think KT has already provided with the details of the projects already underway. And these projects have already had a financial closure, and we expect to spend roughly around 1,300 crores on these projects, mainly for the Worli project, for the next 3 years, including the current financial. And this also includes contribution to the JDA deals that we have already spent. So this 1,300 cash flow requirement is net of cash flows that the real estate business derives from the collections of REIT rentals, as well as the milestone collections from the launch projects. So we thereafter, you know, kind of expect after this 3 years period, we kind of expect the real estate business to turn cash positive from FY24 onwards. So looking at our debt at the beginning of the year, which was around 1400 crores. So if you kind of do the math, we will need to borrow, you know, kind of additionally 600 crores, that is, you know, 1300 crores minus the 700 crores of free cash flows from our manufacturing businesses. Therefore, we expect our peak debt at the end of FY23 around to be close to around 2000 crores with the present deals on the table in the real estate business. Sure, now, for any new JDA deals during this 3 year period, we are looking at tying up partners for our platform funding. And we expect in these new deals, our contribution to be in the aggregate of roughly 500 crores over this 3 year period, which will be an additional debt that we may have to raise, which can actually take our peak debt to 2,500 crores. But our debt equity ratio is, I know, currently around 0.4. And with this increase, it may double up to, let's say, 0.8, which in my opinion is still good enough. Now, I think to answer your question on the future business mix, I think I have a sort of a very short answer. So before that, I think all of us should understand that the revenue recognition in the real estate business happens only when the projects are completed. So given our plans, we expect that to start happening from FY23 onwards. So I don't see much change in the revenue and EBITDA pie till FY22. But from FY23, the share of the real estate will probably start growing exponentially in the revenue and EBITDA mix. And it may actually be as high as 30% of revenue and maybe 40% of EBITDA in FY24 itself. So Anuj, I hope that answers both the questions.
Absolutely, sir. Thank you so much for that. That was definitely elaborate. There are already questions coming in. Participants, just a reminder, if you have any questions, use the Q&A link button at the bottom and you can post your questions there. So let me start right away with the questions. Katie, the first question is for you. So can you throw some color on the FSI norms and expectations on the upcoming potential changes? This is a question by Aman.
I didn't get this question, Anuj. FSI norms on what? Which, I mean, different regions have different.
I assume he's talking about the FSI norms and expectations on the upcoming potential changes in the industry.
So I think with the launch of the new unified DCR, I think, you know, which has just come in. On geographies outside of Mumbai, I think that is going to have a major impact on development rules. We are still studying the impact of that. It has just come out. I think FSI will go up from the current 2.5 on a very broad basis average to almost 3 and above 3 in some areas. But the flip side is that whatever used to be free of FSI now will come under FSI. You have to pay premium, etc. So overall, I think it should be beneficial, but we need to study that in detail and find out, you know, what's going to be the net impact. I'm sure it's going to be a lot more positive than what it is today. But again, the premiums will go up again, unless the government now comes up with, you know, there's a lot of talk going about, you know, premiums coming down by a hefty margin, etc., which should be, you know, advantageous for all of us, especially in Mumbai, if it happens for our Worli project, etc. The calculations are yet to be done, but I think those are going to be positive. So overall, I think the new rules which are coming up should be positive in terms of, you know, more potential for FSI.
Sure.
Yeah.
Next question again, Katie, this is for you from Kunal Mehta. There are news reports of about 50% fall in the premium rates by BMC in Mumbai. Which should help us when we launch our Worli project next year. Can we quantify the amount or the benefit to our company?
Yeah, so is this just speculation at this point of time? There's a huge likelihood. They see newspaper, you know, articles, etc., should help us tremendously because, you know, beyond 1.33 FSI, whatever FSI comes in is through premiums. And if there is a 50% reduction, that should be a big advantage. When it comes in, you know, we will do the calculations. Of course, our FSI, our entire project will come phase-wise. So we haven't planned to, you know, pay all the premiums at one go. It will be paid over a period of, you know, multiple years. So at least, you know, when the impact is, when we are ready to pay our first premium, which will be sometime next financial year, I think that should, and if this rule is applicable, I think we should have a substantial benefit. Difficult to quantify at this point of time, but when it is thus, I'll be happy to let you know.
Sure. Another follow-up question from Sarthak Shah is, what ROI should we expect from the future projects at Lower Parel?
So Lower Parel, the project that we have, which is Worli, which is the Worli project, of course, largely depends on, you know, what sorts of premium we pay. As we know, this is our own land, you know, so land value is historical cost. So I think we should expect very high ROIs. And if the premiums, which are pretty high as of today, if that premiums come down, the ROI should go up. So my expectation is that it should be anywhere between around 35% plus, if not, you know, closer to between 35% to 50%. It could be anywhere, depending on, because these are very high-rise buildings. So there are construction costs. There's a lot of, you know, because very high, tall buildings. So it has its own challenges. And of course, the premiums. So if the premiums crash, as the government is saying, there would be benefit will be more towards closer towards 50%. Otherwise, it will be well above 35%.
Sure. Next question, again, this is for you, Katie, from Sameer Dalal. How much of the land is having litigation in the Worli area?
Just to tell you directly, what I mentioned to you is 30 acres, which is basically the land which is free of litigation.
Okay.
That is clear of litigation. We have 10 acres, which is the overall land we have is 40 acres. So 10 acres is demarcated and kept aside. And what I've talked about, 30 acres is 4 million plus, is all the net that we have, which is clear of all litigations.
Sure. Let me move on to another question. This is from Ritwik Sheth and JP Narayan. It's for you. It's on the paper sector. I think Snehalji already, you know, envisaged this question and answered it to a brief extent. They're asking, you know, what is the capex required to become the market leader in the paper segment, and what is the timeline that we expect for this? Which segments, I think you already mentioned which segments we are looking, but in order to become the market leader, what kind of timeline and capex would be required?
Thanks, Anuj. I think we had made a calculation pre-COVID, and we were anticipating that by 26, we were planning to take a position, second position in the country. And the anticipated capex was during that time, it was somewhere around 800 to 900 crore rupees.
Okay.
This was the tentative calculation.
Sure. And another question, I think, as Snehalji gave a little brief on, is from Aman, is that can you give some further details on the planned capex in the paper segment, the 500 crores and a more granular breakdown of that?
See, it was, I think, pre-COVID, and now we have changed a little bit our strategy. So I think planned capex, which we had put on hold, that is in the range of somewhere 200 crore rupees. 100 crore rupees we had already invested in our tissue commissioning machine is absolutely ready, and we are waiting technician from Sweden to commission that machine and start the commercial production. And the remaining CapEx has been not approved yet. So it depends upon the future. You can see the market condition, how it is picking up. So that is a kind of planned thing.
Okay. Another question from Mr. Ritwik as a follow-up is, can we shift the capacity from writing printing to tissue? You already mentioned in your opening statement that you're doing it towards board, but can you do it towards tissue paper?
Technology of tissue manufacturing is entirely different as compared to writing printing paper as well as the packaging board. We can go into the lower end of the packaging through the writing printing machines, but we cannot go on a tissue.
Understood. Okay, let me move on back to Katie. Some more questions on the real estate side. So Kirit Gogri has a question on, when do you plan to launch the Gurugram project and how much area do you expect to sell in the first 12 months of this launch?
So the project is already launched and we are pretty getting strong response. We have done close to about 150 crores of sales already. I think, we hope to, cross about more than 250 crores very soon. The way the project is going. So I think we should do plus 250 plus by this financial year. That is the first phase of the launch, which is about 6 lakh square feet. So that should be about 3 to 4 lakh square feet.
Okay.
Yeah.
Next question again for you is from Shivam Mitra. Do we have any plans of demerging the real estate business in the future? I think this comes all the time, but what are the thoughts on that?
So that's not my call. So I would, pass on the question to senior management.
Mr. Ladda, would you like to take up this question? So sorry, you'll have to mute and unmute.
Sure. I think this question is frequently there. In fact, our real estate business is a new startup. And definitely at this stage, it needs a lot of support from the manufacturing businesses. So whatever internal generation is there, generally what plan we have is a part of that will just spend for the real estate and part for the respective businesses. So definitely it is in a very preliminary stage and it needs reasonably good support from these businesses. We are lucky to have three focus businesses, out of which two are manufacturing, and that will be a big support for the initial support which real estate business needs. So it will continue for some time, and let's see, once the Worli project is completed, that stage perhaps we'll take appropriate call. What should be our strategy going forward?
Sure, sir. Next question from Mr. Hitesh Doshi is to Mr. Dalmia. Mr. Dalmia, he asks, you said that we are EBITDA positive since October. So his question is, are our profits better than last October at EBITDA levels pre-COVID, or are we still lower?
We're still lower because pre-COVID situation was different. But now the market is not picking up that much. The realization we get on that, so it is lower than that. But EBITDA plus, which was not in earlier months because of pre-COVID and less capacity, are now running almost full capacity, so we are EBITDA plus, but not to the pre-COVID level October.
Sure, sir. Next question I'll take from Ashish Sood. Snailji, I think these will be probably more relevant to you. His first question is, what is the current capital employed and ROE in the textile business? What is the gross block in this business and average life of asset? And what is the reason for decline in EBITDA margins from 2016 levels, which I think Mr. Dalmi has answered also, but he's asking since 2016.
So, Anuj, I think if you can probably put up that chart, which actually gives the breakup of the capital employed.
Yes, I'll do that.
Across this.
Yeah.
So, I think that would probably answer most of his questions, sure. I guess.
This chart is in our presentation also, everyone, so you all can see the entire details. But, Snails, if you want to quickly brief about this.
Yeah, so I mean, roughly his question was how much is the capital employed? Yes, of course, the EBITDA margins are pretty low because, Mr. Dalmia has already answered the reasons for those actually already. So right now, the capital employed is roughly around 500 crores, as you can see. And I guess that is the answer. And just to add to that earlier question, which actually is a good question, which many, and I never tired to answer it, of course, Mr. Ladda has given, is about, I want you to put that chart. So I want to give a perspective to people.
Sure.
Put the same chart.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you see, there is a capital employed of 1800 crores in the real estate business. You know, there was a question on the demerging of real estate business. And if you see that the loan allocation to this particular of our total loan is about 748 crores. Now, for the real estate business to service this particular loan on its own would be a big challenge, because right now their only revenues are the lease rental. And so therefore, this answer to that question, it's too early to answer that question. It has real estate, unless it becomes self-surviving, it is too early to answer that question. I just wanted to, since the chart came up, I just wanted to add another dimension to that.
Sure. His follow-up question is, what is the ROE in the textile business? Snehalji, would you have that information?
Let me address it, Snehal.
Sure, Mr. Dhani.
This ROI is around 8 to 10% in normal course when pre-COVID situation, normal business time. But at present, it is low. Because, as I said, market are not ready to give that much price because of this less demand. So secondly, question, because I've gone through in that question session, in this one question was in 2016, why the profit is less? Because in 2016, the profit was included by VFI profit also, which we are transferred to Grasim. That was a specific question.
Understood.
That I had that include that. And on this gross block, it is 1,000 crores. And second, the average life of asset, also one question in the QA, around 8 to 10 years from now. Okay.
Thank you, sir. I'll take the next question. Mr. Narayan, this is for you. From Ashish Sood, is what is the per kg realization that we can expect going forward for the paper segment? And what is the reason for margin improvement in the paper business from 10.2% in 2015 to 21.5% in 2020?
First question is the average realization. We are anticipating it will be in the range of somewhere around 51,000 to 52,000 rupees, average, putting all the segment together. And if you say improvement, there is a lot of initiative which pulp and paper business has carried out. It was a turnaround in the business where the margin has improved, and the initiatives has taken place on, you can say, the restructuring all the processes, improving efficiencies, working on customer centricity, quality, sustainability. And as a whole, put everything together, has rendered this kind of result in the business.
Got it, sir. The next question he has for real estate, Mr. Jitendran, for the real estate business, you indicated that long-term revenue potential, but can you also guide us, what are the cash flows that the company can achieve from these land parcels in the next 3 to 5 years? Any broad indication on that, please?
So I don't have...
And it is a little bit forward-looking, but broadly, if you can, yeah.
Yeah, I think, depending on the launches, for example, depending on the launches and the milestone collections, we hope about 150 crores. I mean, apart from the leasing collection, leasing will go from 125 to 130 crores is the leasing collection for the next 3 years. From the residential sales, we expect about 150 to 250 crores, average per annum. And early starts that might get accelerated a little bit. So I don't have a number. I mean, I don't spot a number, but it'd be in that region. It may move anywhere between 150 to 250, maybe go up to 300 crores per annum. And later on, when the progress happens, the number of projects happen, it will exponentially grow.
Right, sir. Next question from Smitesh. Kitty, again for you, is what are the total inventory units at Gurugram and how much of it has been sold? I will put up this chart so you can also refer to it, but any indication on that?
Yeah, I think I already answered that. We, as in our first phase launch is about 300 units. We have sold roughly about 100 units or around that, maybe close to about 100 units. As I said, broadly 150 crores of sales has happened. We may cross about 250 crores by the year end, the financial year. I think very strong response. Market price is about 10,500 plus. It's again a premium in that segment, at least by 10-15%, doing very well.
Sure.
So these are again, you know, disclaimer is that these are, you know, very broad numbers. It should not be taken as, you know, forward looking. I mean, with all those disclaimers, I think this is our estimate, broad estimates.
Sure. His next question is regarding our Worli project. Could you please detail the sequential approval process and which are pending approvals today?
So we have got the layout approval, which is most crucial. Pending. So after that, this whole period of the COVID area, the entire BMC. A building proposal was in suspension. There was hardly any work happening. We have applied for the fire NOC, which is under scrutiny right now. Post that, we have to get the environmental clearance. We have a height clearance. Of course, the building plan clearance is there. I think these are the critical ones. Of course, followed by the RERA. Finally, when you get all these approvals, you get the RERA clearance, and then we should be on for the launch.
Okay. And his follow-up is also, any new JVs coming up in the near future?
So we are in the market looking for, you know, good proposals in all markets, all geographies, Bombay, Pune, Bangalore, NCR. We are looking at the right price, right partner, right location, right product, right pricing, etc. We are in this process negotiating with several partners. Whenever we finalize something, we'll be very happy to let everybody know on that.
Okay. Next question from Swecha Jain, again for you, Katie, is can you please elaborate on the JV deals with developer partners such as revenue share, capital contribution, etc.? Any details further on the 2-3 JVs that we have?
So the JVs that we already have, you know, we have the model is largely either revenue share or profit share. In revenue share, of course, the top line is shared. We give a deposit, which is about 20 to 30% of the perceived land value, which we eventually adjust from the JV partner's share of revenue. In a profit sharing, we do the same thing, but the profit is shared. So we have risks covered both from the revenue and cost side. We agree on a business plan with a certain tolerance, and then we again give a deposit, and the deposit is adjusted from the JV partner's share of profits. So broadly, that's the model we look at it. We could also look at area sharing, but the GST etc. has made that model cumbersome. So broadly, these are the three types of things we are doing. So far, all of our JVs, the two which we have done, one in Magadi Road and one in NCR, which is with the Anant Raj Estate, both have been profit sharing.
And would you mind elaborating? I think she's asking about the specific percentage. Would you mind elaborating on that?
So NCR is 50-50 profit sharing. Bangalore is 60% to the JV partner and 40% to us.
Okay. Next question from Mehul Soni. When we talk about shifting to asset-light model in real estate, do we plan to monetize any existing assets or lands? If yes, which ones and how much of cash flow do we expect from this? Are we talking about monetizing the lands only?
Broadly, we're not planning to do that. We will keep evaluating at every point of time what's the best use for this land. It's quite possible some of the lands which are agricultural land, we could put into better use rather than, you know, if it is not ready for residential or if it is not ready for residential the next few years, then we would always look at what's the best next way to do it. Should we look at warehousing centers? We should look at data centers. We should look at, you know, giving it for management institutes, education institutes, or do some other things, etc. So there are several of those possibilities. So we'll keep exploring that from time to time. And the most best decision, which is in the favor of the company, we will keep taking that. We have a large land parcel, but most of our lands in Mumbai, like Worli and you know, all these lands, I think we would, of course, go for development. I think that's how we exploit or unlock the maximum potential for the land.
Sure. Next question from Sagar Naik is, any details on the residential real estate in NCR and Mumbai, Bangalore? Are players offering high incentives? So this is more on the industry perspective. Are players offering higher incentives and discounts today?
So as I said, for ready possession or, you know, closer to move-in, you know, closer to completion, there are schemes available. Lots of schemes are available, especially in Mumbai, parts of NCR, you know, so I think the market is taking full advantage of that. Current, you know, because of financial situation of some of the developers, etc., there has been lots of schemes available at discounts. And I think, therefore, there has been a lot of traction also in the market. But this is largely on the products which are closer to possession. As far as we are concerned, we have not offered any discounts or anything. And our response continues to be very strong and positive in all markets.
Sure. Next question from, I'll take from Rahul Jain is, as per Q2 FY21 presentation, we have a cumulative sales of 340 crores in Kalyan and 115 crores in Bangalore till September. What is the total advances have been received for the same, as I could not get that from September results? So any advances on that, do you know?
I don't have the numbers as of now.
But on an average, would it be what percentage? Yeah,
so I think we have collected about 30-35 crores in Bangalore so far. 30-35 crores, and in NCR, of course, we have collected the, you know, the just about, it just started, so I think about 20-25 odd crores. I don't have a fix on that number. It's somewhere around that. It's sure. About early 20s or maybe, you know, late teens or something like that.
Sure. Again, the next question is from,
we have collected about 90 crores 90-91 crores.
Again, another question on real estate is from Kashish Ambani. So when do we expect all the approvals? You already talked about the approvals for, on another question, but when do we expect all of them to come? Because they've been delayed, as per him, for a very long time. And when do we? What is the realistic expectation for the launch of the Worli project?
Yeah, so as I said, we have been beset with several challenges in Worli. It's a textile mill land. It has its challenges, so we have, you know, one by one tackled all of them, and we are in the process of tackling. And when the, as I saw, the BMC was not really operational for many months, you know, in terms of approval. I would like to believe that we have put that behind. We were going all out after getting those, now that things are back in operation in full scale. So my expectations is that in a year's time from now, we should be able to bring it to the market.
Okay.
Less than a year's time.
Sure. Next question again for you is, what is the average ticket size that you are targeting in the residential and commercial segments in each of the different areas? If you could just highlight on that as well.
So there's no specifics as that. The markets change. It's depending on each micro market. We are not really looking at this point of time for any commercial development. That is more medium to long term. On the residential, depending on which market, which micro market, we are targeting that. For example, like Kalyan today, we are selling at 7,500 per square foot on sellable area plus. NCR, we're selling at 10,000 rupees plus. Bangalore, we're selling at today in that micro market at 6,500. Maybe Magdi Road will sell closer to 9,000-10,000. So we want to be in the premium or mid premium plus, you know, upper mid area. Largely, as I said, the focus is to be able to employ a very strong construction contractor who is absolutely compliant with total focus on quality, safety, sustainability, and all the compliances. I think that's very important, the delivering the right quality and delivering to the customer the right time. So that's my prime focus. I think if you do that, automatically we will get the premiums. So we are definitely at this point of time not operating in the affordable segment. So above that is what our focus is. I would rather say 6,000 rupees plus square foot as of now. And in Mumbai, of course, we're at much higher levels. So I think that's the midterm strategy. And then we will evaluate it as we go forward.
Sure. Next question again for you is from Sahil Doshi. Strategy wise, is it not better sticking to a single residential market or state? Historically, players who have spread themselves thin haven't done well. So any thoughts on that?
Yeah, so I'm very clear on this. The advantage of brands like us is that we are national brands. We have, national demand, unlike local players who is not known nationally. We are much more than a real estate brand. The brand is known as a strong business brand. It's an industry brand. It encompasses much more than a real estate. So such kind of brands has, much more stronger equity across nations, across regions, across geographies. So that's one very clear reason why we should take advantage of it. Number two is that real estate, though it's a very local game, I completely agree with that. But however, it's a high risk game, because if something happens in a particular region, then the entire project gets stuck for months and years. For example, let's say Bombay, a particular DCR or development control rules or some committee is not formed for months, then your project gets stuck and you are completely, for months, you will not get any revenue. So that's a high risk strategy. I think diversification of risk requires that you should be in multi regions. That assures your risk is diversified and an assured cash flow from various markets. If one market fails or gets stopped, the other market delivers. So I think it's a good balance that we are in three or four markets, so that risk gets diversified and we can afford to do that. We understand all these markets where we are. So that's the only reason I think we are in.
Fair point. Management, there are a lot of questions. Do you mind if I take a few more? I know we had a hard stop at 5:15. Can we give another 5 minutes?
I think you should take another 5 minutes. Not an issue.
Sure. Thank you, sir. So next question I'll take, and this is for Mr. JP Narayan. Mr. Narayan, how is the margin profile in tissue packaging versus writing printing paper? Can you just highlight on that?
Yes. Pre-COVID, I think writing printing paper was leading. But right now, tissue is leading and packaging is number two and writing printing is number three.
So broadly, if you could give the range of the margin?
Tissue is in the range of somewhere right now in the range of 17%. Packaging is somewhere around 14-15% and writing printing is, it's no margin right now. It's very low.
Okay. And his follow-up question is that his channel checks tell that the pricing has gone up significantly in paper. Wanted to know your thoughts on the same and how has the pricing supply demand scenario recently been? I think you already highlighted on that, but any thoughts on the pricing scenario right now?
Pricing in two segment, tissue as well as in packaging, has started inching up. But pricing in writing printing, it's stable or still going down because there is a very less demand and whosoever is buying on his own terms and conditions.
Next question, again, back to you, Mr. KT. What are the plans for the Prabhadevi land? Since it's likely to be an ultra premium project, what's the sense of the appetite for such a project post-COVID, especially in context of companies like DLF facing issues in projects like Camellia?
So our focus right now, Anuj, is on Worli and the other projects. Prabhadevi, of course, is a great project, but as very rightly said, we are in no hurry to do that. We'll take our time assessing the demand supply in the market. So at the appropriate time, we will, consider developing that land. I agree with that. This is not the opportune time for, bringing that into the market. We rather focus on Worli, where the volumes are much larger and the ticket size is also more as per the market demand today. While we will wait and bide our time, when that project has to be launched.
Sure. Next question again for you is from Kashish Sambani. How much is the collection efficiency today and how much lease rentals are coming up for negotiations?
So good question, Kashish. We are, the collections are good. We are in the close to about 89-90% collection efficiency. We are facing challenges from the retail clients, which is a very minuscule portion for us. It's only maybe 2-3% of our turnover. There are some bigger clients also because they work from home. We are facing challenges largely from when we are renegotiating the new terms, the kind of premiums, etc. We are facing pressures for negotiations there, and I think we may have to let go some of those premiums or back end it as we go ahead. So there are some pressures, so far we have not given any concessions, but it's quite likely that we may have to relent to some of them, considering the the tough situation in the market, and especially lower parallel where there's lots of supply coming up.
Sure. I'll take one final question. This is from Shivam Junjunwala. Again, Katie, this is for you. What is the construction cost per square feet are we looking at in the Worli project for the residential part?
Broad numbers, we are far away from fixing the cost because we are at the design. We just finished the design. We submitted for approvals. We have submitted for fire. There could be a lot of revisions, etc. Suggestions from the corporation. Largely, it must be considering that this is going to be a very high-rise tall tower, somewhere in the region between 8,000 to 10,000 rupees per square foot.
Sure, sir. Participants, I see that some of the questions we've not been able to answer. Most of those questions can be answered by us, and a lot of that information is available on the current investor presentations. If you need anything, please reach out to us. Mr. Ladha, would you like to leave everyone with some closing statements?
This particular financial year, due to COVID, we are focusing on health of the employees, taking care of all the stakeholders, entire supply chain. We are focusing on the customers, trying to understand their difficulties and trying to solve them. Going forward, we have a very good strategy in place. Once the situation becomes normal, which we hope it will take some time, definitely month after month, quarter after quarter, things are improving. And it will take quite a bit to reach to the pre-COVID levels. But I think we are very positive, and we feel that situation will become normal. The news of vaccine really has created very positive sentiments across the globe, and that definitely will help in our segments. So thank you very much.
Great. Thank you, management, for participating, and thank you, everybody, for participating. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you.
Thank you.